So we're here today talking to Gavin Newlands, MP for Paisley and Renfrewshire North, about life as a Westminster MP. We're 100 days into the new Parliament, and Gavin's going to give us a behind-the-scenes look at what actually goes on in the House of Commons. So firstly, though, to get back a little bit, back to the campaign, I remember the canvassing results were pretty amazing. At what point did you think, I can actually win this?
Well, I think the canvassing results were pretty spectacular. I think from early on, we thought we had a really strong chance of winning. But I think in terms of confidence, I started off confident, but towards polling day, I think confidence started to erode with me. I think when it came to polling day itself, I actually woke up, despite having thought for a good kind of 2 or 3 weeks beforehand that we were going to take the seat, on polling day itself, I thought perhaps we're going to just fall short. And I said this to Derek as we were going round on polling day, and I think I infected him with my negativity as well that day. But obviously, in the end, we ended up with an even larger majority than we'd ever dream of. So throughout the whole campaign, it was looking pretty positive. But on the day itself, it was a few jitters from myself.
So tell us how it felt when you heard the returning officer shout out your name.
Well, completely surreal, I think would be the only way to put it. I mean, from fairly early on, it was looking pretty clear that we had won. I mean, I'd told John, my agent, not to contact me until he was really sure which way it was going to go. I can't remember the exact time I said to him, but don't contact me until at least 12:30 or thereabouts. But he sent me a message at about 11:40 and saying we were scooshing it. And so I just ignored the phone at that point. I thought it's far too early to say that. But he gave me another 10, 15 minutes and phoned me up and said, listen, we're winning. There's no two ways about it. At the end of the day, we were walking at that point. So when I got down to the count and I could see the votes on the table, and in some tables there was kind of 3 bundles of SNP votes to Labour's 1, and most of them it was kind of 2-1, but that was surreal in itself. So getting called round to the side and have the returning officer confirm the result and the majority and whatever else. It didn't sink in that night. It didn't sink in for, I have to be honest, probably a few weeks thereafter. I feel like an MP now, but it was quite a long time that it didn't quite feel real, to be perfectly honest.
Did you know at that stage how well the SNP were doing across the country?
Well, I'd had an idea. I mean, certainly after I went back to my house kind of 10 o'clock, and in fact I left the campaign office 10 o'clock, and there was exit polls and what have you, and as soon as somebody told me that the exit polls had predicted, I just laughed and said that can't possibly be true. And I thought at that point, if they were saying that, then there was a good chance we might get close to 50, and if we were going to get close to 50, then perhaps we were going to take this seat, because I think we were kind of 41 or thereabouts on the list if the swing was going to be uniform. So at that point, it was looking pretty good across the country at that point, but I don't think anybody really thought we'd end up with 56, including Nicola and various others. I mean, you can crunch the numbers all you like, and certainly the canvas returns across the country were phenomenally strong, but to actually then turn that into 56 MPs is phenomenal, and I don't know if we'll ever see the like of that again, but certainly it was good. It's been good for Scotland in this campaign, that's for sure.
So between that day and heading to London for the first time, what was happening during those days? Was it just crazy?
It was crazy. I mean, I was trying to catch up with sleep with little success. And on the Saturday, we all the MPs met up at the fourth bridge for quite a famous picture. So that was the first time I met at least 30 of our MPs. I mean, I've known some of them, I've campaigned for some of them over the years, but certainly there's a good number of them that some of them I hadn't even heard of, let alone met. And so it was a good day to try and kind of put names to faces, and I didn't get a chance to speak to everyone. But I think the Sunday was spent as much time with the family as I could, just getting ready to go down to London on the Monday morning on Gale Force 1 or whatever title they wanted to give us for that flight down to London.
So it's been hailed as a breath of fresh air, the SNP MPs, in the House of Commons. What was the reception like from the incumbents, those that were already there?
I think most of them, they were a bit standoffish at first. I think they wanted to kind of gauge what we were like initially, and I think as time's gone on, I think they've warmed to us. I think certainly from the Labour point of view, I think there was a wee bit of hostility from some, because obviously we're just taking a lot of their friends in a lot of cases seats, and we can depart nationally fairly massively, to be fair. The Tories, I mean, is one of the best comments I think we've had that kind of sums up, as maybe Edward Lee, I'm not sure, it was a Tory MP that stood up in the chamber and he said there just seems to be more Scottish MPs now, as regards to contribution and turning up for debates and whatever else, not more SNP, just more Scottish MPs. So that, I think that in itself tells you that we're in a stronger presence for Scotland than the previous MPs were. So it's been good so far, and we've been met with a really positive response from the staff as well. The staff themselves, they've been extremely welcoming from the start, and they've been first class, and a lot of the MPs themselves have warmed to our presence, perhaps more than they thought they would. The Speaker's also said some kind remarks recently as well, said in the Chamber, and I think he repeated it just recently at the Edinburgh Festival, so it's been good so far.
So your maiden speech, that must have been utterly nerve-wracking.
It was. I think my mind was concentrated somewhat. I made my maiden speech during the budget debate, and the budget debate lasts for 4 days, the day of the budget itself, etc. So on three of those days, there was no time limit in any of the speeches, any of the backbench speeches at all. So I'd thought that it'd be the same for Maddy. I spoke on the third day of the debate, and so I had like an 11 and a half minute speech, and I think I had a 9 minute speech just in case of a time limit, because I thought worst case scenario there might be a time limit of 8 minutes perhaps, if I was unlucky and there was one story I could take out and that'd be 8 minutes or thereabouts. Then we found out it was going to be 6 minutes, there was a time limit, and I'm sitting there panicking, and I think a lot of my friends and family were watching, because obviously everyone seems to watch Parliament TV, but everyone was watching it live, and if you're watching, you can just see me with screens of paper all around as I'm hastily trying to edit my speech down into 6 minutes. In the end I thought I'd managed it, but in the end my speech was 6 minutes and 50 odd seconds long, so the Deputy Speaker did me a favour by allowing me to continue for that long. But in terms of making the speech, I was surprised, to be honest, in the end how kind of calm I felt in the lead up to it, perhaps because I was so busy trying to edit my speech, but calm in the lead up to it, and then when she called my name and I got up, I was nervous, but it was I could cope with those nerves. I wasn't overwhelming at all, and the speech went reasonably well. I was quite happy I managed to fit in what I could into my 6 minutes plus, that I managed to talk about the constituency and a lot of the issues that that matter to me, and hopefully a lot of my constituents as well. So I was really pleased with how it went in the end, despite the time limit.
I've been loving the tweets and the blogs from the SNP MPs, and I'm sure many other people have as well, getting an insight into Westminster, if you want to call it that. Is it really as archaic as we're led to believe?
It's ridiculous is probably the best word. I mean, it is, everything's archaic and what have you. And I mean, I've made a point several times, and I've put out several tweets myself, and I think I put a tweet out about the Tory MPs brain like donkeys and like the 18th century and whatever else. These are obviously traditions that a lot of them cherish, to be perfectly honest, and it's the mother of all parliaments and etc. And I'm happy if they want to keep some tradition. If they want to keep, I mean, there's various things like the speaker processes before the start of business, with processes through the parliament. There's the mace, the sergeant of arms in their fancy dress, essentially, with their swords and all the rest of it. If they want to keep all that kind of frippery, then fine. But in the day-to-day running of the parliament, then I think they should really bring it a lot closer, even if they bring it into the 20th century, let alone the 21st century, in terms of the voting and whatever else. The voting system is utterly farcical. Any time there's a vote called, you've got 8 minutes to get to chamber. That's another issue, the fact that our office, that nice office though it is a fair bit away from the chamber, and it's touch and go sometimes if you can make the chamber in time, or the voting lobby in time, within the 8 minutes. But beside the chamber, you've got two long rooms, and you have to go in these rooms and make yourself known to a clerk at the end of the room in order to vote. And if you're trying to funnel 300 MPs through one room with three people at the end, this is why it takes almost 15 mm-hmm. minutes or thereabouts for each vote. So the minute you've got three and four votes in something, that's an hour.
Mm-hmm.
You're taking just a vote, whereas in the Scottish Parliament, obviously, you're just pressing a button and seconds later, you know the vote. So they could really do it. That's the most obvious thing and the quickest thing they could do to make some of the procedures a bit more modern. But it's funny, I was actually with, I think it was Brendan O'Hara. We were standing waiting to vote, but we're waiting on the tellers. So at the end, we can make ourselves known to the clerks, but you have to walk through the door, single file at the end, and the tellers, which are the folk that announce the votes at mm-hmm. the table in the chamber, they have to be in position. So we're waiting for that to happen. We're talking away with the clerk, and we're talking about modernising voting and saying we've all got parliamentary iPads, could we not vote on iPads? And the clerk said, we're actually trialling iPads in September, so we're going to be using iPads for voting, etc., etc. And Brendan and I looked at her and said, that's excellent, we haven't heard this, and it's fantastic news. And he said, so we'll be sitting in the chamber and we'll be able to vote, or do we have to go somewhere to vote? Or, and he said, oh no, we instead of a big pad of paper which they cross your name out, they're just going to have iPads instead. So we still have to go through the whole farce of going into this room and waiting. They're just going to have a digital tablet at the end rather than a pad of paper.
Crazy.
That's how quickly modernise in the House of Commons.
And clapping, loving the clapping, is it going to continue? Or?
Well, I would like to think that we would try and do something. I mean, I'm not a big fan of hear. If you say just hear, it's not so bad. It's the Tories when they make whatever that noise is. It's certainly not hear. It's a weird hybrid of hear. But certainly John Nicholson continues to applaud at every turn in the chamber. But I'm not sure. I don't know how much of an issue we're going to make of that, because at the end of the day, there's some big issues we need to deal with between the welfare reform bill mm-hmm. and the budget mm-hmm. and et cetera, et cetera. I don't want too much focus to be on our clapping or behaviour in the Parliament. I'd rather focus on the actual issues at hand.
Sure.
Don't get me wrong, I think it's a farce that in 2015 we can't have a few seconds applause rather than making some weird noise.
Mm-hmm.
And I hope that the Parliament will see sense and we can perhaps do something like that. But I don't think we should waste too much time in trying to kind of force that onto the Parliament. I think we should go on with the other
mm-hmm.
what we're sent here to do, effectively.
Yeah. So you were sent there to do a job, and mm. all of the MPs have been given roles and committees and tasks to take forward. What's your remit?
Well, it's kind of twofold. We've all got places on committees. I mean, my committee is the Backbench Business Committee, which is actually really useful for the party to have a voice on that committee. I mean, we've only had one meeting so far, and we've put business on for one day. I should explain that the Backbench Business Committee hears or listens to backbench MPs come forward, put the case for a debate that they want to have. That debate could be in the chamber, it could be like they try and have a binding vote on it, or it could be in Westminster Hall, it could be anything that they want to have. But obviously times are very limited, so it's up to the committee to decide who gets that time. And the first debate, or the first day of business that we've decided, actually has two debates that really suit us in terms of the sustainable development goals and about immigration and Yarlswood and other areas like that. So it's good kind of left wing areas for us to debate. So it's quite handy that I've been able to use my voice on that committee mm-hmm. for that. But in the wider sense of the group, I'm on the Scotland and the Constitution policy group with various others. Pete Wishart, Angus Robertson leads the group. So obviously the Bench referendum and evil and the Scotland Bill and all the rest mm-hmm. of it, it's quite a busy group and quite an important policy group at the moment. And I think if you could pick a policy group to be in, I think most of us in the SNP would choose to be in the Scotland Constitution group. So I'm extremely happy to be in that group just now. Whether that these groups last for those 5 years, whether they rotate mm-hmm. around, I'm not entirely sure. But at the moment, as a way of managing the group, etc., it's working mm-hmm. really well.
So obviously Parliament's in recess at the moment.
Mm-hmm.
What's the first challenge when you head back down to Westminster when summer's over?
The first challenge, heading back down to Westminster, I mean, if you look at it from the point of view that I made my maiden speech fairly late on, towards the end of the first session, if you like, is to get my teeth into more debates within the Parliament itself. The SNP group itself is taking on a large staff at the moment, so hopefully we'll have a backup team in place, because obviously the SNP had 6 MPs before and had staff to cope with 6 MPs, but now we've got 56, so it's a somewhat different operation being a third party. So they've taken on a large number of staff over the summer recess. We'll get to know them and what have you. But in terms of Westminster itself, it's about getting my teeth into debates and making this constituency's voice heard in those debates, because I've only made one speech and intervention in Westminster Hall and asked one question. So I'm looking forward to getting stuck into it.
So I understand you've set a schedule of 12 surgeries a month, and that's quite a commitment. What kind of constituency issues are you dealing with?
Well, we've put a wide range of issues. We've dealt with and are dealing with HMRC issues with regards to benefits, welfare reform, the welfare cap, the benefits cap. We've got two or three people who are now struggling because of the cap, and the cap set to reduce further, obviously, following the budget down to £20,000 outside London. But the issue that's kind of the number one issue between surgeries, emails, phone calls, people calling into the office, is probably housing, and that's all across housing. The main issue is, I would have to say, is a lack of housing to go to. People that are getting essentially kicked out of their house, whether it's a private landlord or a housing association, for whatever reason, there's a complete lack of houses to go to, and this is despite the Scottish Government building so many houses. I think it's 27,000 out of the 30,000 target at the moment. So there's still, while the SNP government are building a lot of houses, still a long way to go if we're going to meet that demand, especially with bedroom tax, etc. at the moment, until we can do away with it.
So just one last question. Mm-hmm. 5 years at Westminster, what's your personal goal that you want to achieve by the end of that time?
My personal goal is that probably that position won't exist in 5 years. Obviously, we're all SNP MPs. We still want independence for Scotland. We still think that's the best way forward for Scotland. And it's not independence for its own sake. It's independence for a reason. I mean, all these issues we're dealing with, welfare reform, etc., etc. We want independence so we can deal with those issues on our own terms, with our own revenue, etc., etc. So I would hope that in 5 years' time, we're looking forward as a roadmap to doing away with my current job, and we're looking forward to independence. When that will be is a matter for the Scottish people and Nicola Sturgeon.
Gavin, thanks very much for your time.
No problem.
I really appreciate it. That's been great.
Thanks very much.